and welcome to Big Deal. Now, we know that private equity space is getting extremely important. In fact, they are doling out more cash in M&A transactions than the strategics are doing at this point. So given their importance, I have been speaking to many private equity players. So this week on the episode, I'll have with me Warburg Pincus, Chris Capital, and then we'll be also joined by Sanjeev Krishnan of PwC to talk about the overall themes and trends in the private equity space. So let's first take it to Vishal Mahadevia of Warburg Pincus, who says that he is interested in the stressed asset space in the country as IBC has matured and evolved right now, and also will be looking at financial services space, especially in the fintech vertical of that sector. In my first question, stressed asset space is seeing maximum number of M&A. How is Warburg Pincus poised for this space?
I think we're watching it very closely. I think while there's been a lot of activity in the stressed asset space, the number of closed deals and actual resolutions is still taking time, but it's actually moving a lot faster than we expected. I think it's a fantastic code, the bankruptcy code. These things are path-breaking in many ways.
Right.
And as it makes progress, I think you will see Warburg Pincus playing in this. We're not typically what you would call a distressed investor, but there are some very good assets that with a strong management team, we can back, grow and put more capital, and that's really what we want to do.
All right. So help me understand, many private equity firms have shown their interest in this particular space, but we haven't seen any investments coming in from there. Are the regulations, the entire process, the way it's going, is that comforting, or would you look at outside of IBC still when you focus on stressed assets?
I think we would definitely look outside of IBC. I don't think it has to go into IBC for us to necessarily get involved with an asset.
Right.
I think what it's driving is different behavior. So I think you see more companies trying to resolve this outside of IBC, because once it goes in, it can go out of your control and therefore be a longer process. I am very happy with the regulations. I actually think, as I said, the way it's gone is better than I expected. You can always hope it goes even better than that.
Right.
And you can always wish for more. That is India, that is us.
Right.
But I am very hopeful that you will see more and more things happen.
All right, so in terms of strategy, what will you look at? Would you look at a company which is loss-making, which needs restructuring? Will you have your expertise on board, or would you be buying out portfolio and selling it? How are you going to strategize?
Very good question, Nisha. So our strategy would be very similar to what we do right now.
Right.
It's just the buying it out of a company that is distressed versus buying a company that's a good company and growing. Our strategy is find a good business or a good asset and create a business out of it, grow it, because we are growth investors, and many times capital and also new talent, which is very important. When a company is in trouble, it's hard to attract great talent. So you back a fantastic management team, which is what we do, provide more capital and take an asset that's good but has been underperforming and then turn it into a growth company. That's what we want to do.
Necessarily, would you also look at infusing equity and tying up with a promoter? Do you believe that sometimes in a business a promoter is still required, which is not the case in IBC most of the time?
Yeah, I think I'd be very careful about classifying every business that gets into trouble or goes to IBC as necessarily having a bad promoter. That's not true. So in many of these cases, these are good businesses. For different reasons, they have found their capital structure flawed. And as either Warburg Pincus or private equity as a capital provider, you should be in the position to back them.
Right.
I think you need to change the trajectory of the business. And many times it's not just capital.
Right.
If it was just capital, you don't need Warburg Pincus.
Right.
You need, when you need Warburg Pincus, bring capital, attract talent, bring in a different level of governance and oversight. And if a promoter in a company is willing to do that, absolutely we should be capital providers to work with them.
Can I say in some way that you're bringing a different kind of a product altogether to India, because we haven't seen you do restructuring, even though overseas you do have that particular space, that particular business. So do you think that it will be a new kind of a business, new kind of a vertical for you, which you haven't done in India?
I think less so, Nisha, because just to classify what I'm talking about doing, it's less about let's go in, create a different capital structure and put in a different type of debt, or buy the debt a little cheaper and then trade it out later, or buy the debt and then take control of a company. Those are very different products.
Right.
That's not something I would say is what is our focus right now. Our focus is to find those good businesses that have got into trouble because of other issues, but then go in with a private equity mindset.
Okay, still
born
pure
with an
play
ownership
equity.
And private equity. Oh, yes, absolutely okay. Equity. Our product and our mindset and what we do well is bring equity, but to bring it to distressed situations
yes.
versus saying what we've historically done in India, which is more growth capital and good companies and...
All right, so thanks for that clarity and distinguishing that. Apart from that, which are the sectors right now that you are keen on for investments? Would you say that you are in an investment mode right now?
I think our actions speak louder than my words, Nisha. We've been on investment mode for a while. We are very, we've been for 25 years almost now, proponents of India, and I think we remain that way. Challenges always exist in India as in other geographies around the world, but we're very much in investment mode. Last year, as you know, we invested and committed over $1 billion of investments into India, mm-hmm. and our pipeline continues to be very, very healthy. We see terrific opportunities and terrific entrepreneurs. To answer your question, no particular sector. I think we're seeing it broad-based across different sectors. Just good entrepreneurs and large opportunities, which is a change.
While you have other many categories and eligibility criteria, but I would still ask you, which are the sectors? Is it like mid-cap IT, mid-cap pharma, which are closer to the private equity world than the others? Are those the areas which interest you right now?
So mid-cap IT, mid-cap pharma we're looking at. We're looking at financial services,
right.
We're looking at logistics, we're looking at multiple different areas where we have good entrepreneurs and good businesses. If I ask you, one area where we're not seeing a lot of traction yet is still in the infrastructure space.
Yes.
And in also the industrial product space and the manufacturing space, not as much opportunity. That's not because we don't like it. We're just not seeing those opportunities present themselves as well as we would maybe like to.
All right. While you talk about these sectors, financial services stands out because you did make a few investments there. You have IDFC First Bank as well, and you have India First Life Insurance in which you invested. Do you have more appetite for this sector where there are plenty of opportunities?
Absolutely. As you know, about a year, a little over a year ago, we raised a dedicated global
yes.
financial services and fintech investing fund. Just to invest in the sector side by side with our global fund. I would say globally, when you look at Warburg, I would say we are maybe the or one of the leading financial services private equity investors around the world. We've done it across different geographies.
Right.
Tim Geithner, who's a former Treasury Secretary, is now President of Warburg Pincus. He brings a tremendous amount of expertise mm-hmm. and knowledge. And so we plan to do more of that in India. We have, touch wood, had success with it. In the past, we have a great network of people. India First, as you talked about, is one of our newer investments.
Yes.
Vaidya has been a fantastic experience and a long way to go, we
yes.
still think, with
yes.
the new
you
bank
just ventured
merger.
Into that bank, yes.
That's right. And we have CAMS, we have ICICI Lombard, we have Fusion Microfinance. You will see more from us.
More, any particular pocket, because it's such a diverse sector as well.
Find me a good management team. And I think the opportunity in financial services and technology, financial technologies, is limitless right now in India. It is really defined by what an entrepreneur wants to build and what that team wants to build. But we have, I would say, four or five different micro themes we're looking at. But if I tell you what they are, it will be on TV and I won't be the only one looking at them.
All right, so you don't want to divulge that. But I will ask you, a lot of the investment decisions are also based on how the macros of a country is really developing. We are at a time when things are quite uncertain. We have tension at the border, and we also have elections coming up. How do you see this particular phase?
First, look, tensions at the border. First, I would say my heart goes out to our armed forces. The Indian Air Force, and that is something that is more important than anything we talk about on the investment side. But stepping back from the macro and just talking about the macro economy, I think India is a phenomenal country, and I think we're only now going to see in the next 5 years the benefits
yeah.
of all the reforms that have come into play. But the one thing I would say about macro, when you look at India today, macro is not great. It's
yes.
good.
Yes.
It's not great from a macro economy point of view. But we should not expect anything different. When you do these type of reforms, Nisha, it has a short-term pain element, right? You don't get the long-term gain unless you go through some short-term growth pains.
Okay.
So I'm a big believer that those gains will come. I think we need to be patient on it. And the entrepreneurial spirit in India, the strength of our country, the way our nation is being built, just gives me a great amount of hope. So,
just one last question on exits. You would have some investments in your portfolio which would also be ripe for exits as well, and making the returns. Do you think this market is really helping, because it's really volatile right now? So what are the challenges there, and how do you view that?
I think the markets are definitely volatile, and it is more difficult to exit a company today. But I would say for good companies, we see no dearth of investors and investment interest. We see it as inbound interest coming into our portfolio. I would say some of the biggest mistakes in India that we have made in our 25 years here have been exiting investments too early.
Okay.
So we want to be calibrated about when we exit. And when you find a good entrepreneur and a good company, you want to stay with them as long as you can, as long as that company is growing. Vaidyanathan and IDFC First is a great example of that. Where we continue to want to stay with that company.
And your relations with Bharti is also legendary.
Absolutely.
All right. Thank you so much, Vishal, for
your time.
Thank
you, Nisha.
Thank you. Take it straight to Chris Capital then. Sanjay Kukreja of Chris Capital joined me, and he says that he is bullish on India in the long run, but definitely is cautious ahead of the elections. Chris Capital, how is it poised right now, especially when the markets have been so volatile?
So I think we are very well placed. You know, we've had very few, you know, successful fundraise. As markets are volatile, it's always a good time to actually be well, from a capital raise point of view. And we wait for the opportune time to actually come and deploy more capital. So volatile times are actually decent, because they can find, you can find opportunities, you can find dislocations to take advantage of and invest in the markets. In listed markets, but also listed markets form the framework for deals that happen on the private markets as well.
Right.
And there's certainly certain pockets, certain areas where, you know, you're seeing a lot of value also emerge in the private side as well. So that's quite interesting from our point of view.
When you say value emerge in private side, any particular sectors that you have in mind?
You know, I think we saw a very big run up in valuations in financial services.
Yes.
You know, last couple of years, 3-4 years in a row. I even wrote about it in Mint, saying, look, things are quite crazy in financial services. I see a reversal of that trend.
Right.
Clearly, that has played out in the last 6-9 months. And that's here to stay. But I think that does provide, you know, good entry opportunities for firms like ourselves, which have always been very active in financial services. You know, good correction is healthy.
Right.
And then provides a good framework to get in and then actually build from here on.
Okay. So are you also suggesting that we've hit the bottom, because there have been many issues that have plagued the entire financial services sector, and a lot of people are of the view that we've just seen the tip of the iceberg. So do you see further correction? Would you be a little skeptical, or you, as you said right now, that this correction is healthy and maybe provides a good entry point?
So I would break it up between banking and NBFCs.
Yes, it's a large space.
So on the banking side, I think, you know, there has been a long tail of, you know, recognition led by the RBI, led by the regulators, led by the companies, and therefore gross NPAs and all of that has really gone up in the country. It's probably peaked or getting close to that point where it's there. And if you, you know, fast forward 5 years, you will definitely see a lower, a much healthier financial services banking sector than exists today. So we feel that cycle will, you know, play out more positively. Coming to the consumer finance or NBFC space, again, there are sub-segments within that. I think consumer finance has played out reasonably well. It's the corporate side of NBFCs which has had some issues.
Yes.
There are some industry structural changes that may happen there.
Yes.
Things like, you know, lending to promoter lending might move into fund structures as opposed to necessarily NBFC formats. So that's a trend we're seeing. May not have bottomed out on that side. Liquidity is, you know, re-emerging. I think things are better today than they were 6 months ago or 3 months ago post ILFS. Those are the sectors in which I think valuation has emerged, but business challenges still continue to be there.
Yes.
And that will play out. But from a private equity perspective, we're not looking at the next 1 or 2 quarters. We're essentially looking to build a business over 5 to 7 years.
Yes.
And therefore, some of these dislocations provide good entry multiples, provide good entry points to actually build businesses over the long term and create value.
Okay, so you were talking about NBFCs. Would would you also look at like insurance, housing finance companies? These are the spaces, and which are the particular pockets of financial services on which you are more optimistic about?
So it's, you know, it's a mixed bag. I think clearly you have a lot of opportunity in these areas. We're not tapped out in housing finance. Long-term retail credit to GDP is still like 10-11%. We have a long way to grow. So structurally, the macro is strongly behind you. You have near-term problems. You have to kind of weather the crisis and also come out from there. You know, the LAP problem has to be put behind you.
Yes.
Builder financing has to be put behind you. But long-term, there is a lot of value to be, you know, made in that sector, and we will continue to be interested in there. I think insurance is also a great area to look at. Mm. Both general insurance and life insurance are underpenetrated.
And there are many available there.
There are assets available, there are opportunities available, so it's a good time in financial services, from Chris Capital's perspective, and we're certainly excited about that space.
Which are the other areas that excite you right now?
So we're very strong in pharma, healthcare. We've done a lot of deals in that sector. We're still seeing opportunities there. Again, there were macro headwinds from US as well as pricing pressure, DPCO, all of that. I think those things are settling. Valuations also settling.
Right.
So we find, you know, good opportunities in pharma and healthcare sector as well. Business services has always been a great area for us. I don't think valuations are attractive anymore. This fair valuations may be somewhat stretched as well, but companies are still doing well, US economy is still doing well. There's a threat of US slowdown and therefore what that impact could be on business services. But there is still, you know, a scope for that. I think the one area, consumer is still worrisome.
Yes.
For us, because, you know, valuations there, somehow we can't make the math work. We find that, you know, quite stretched.
All right. And apart from this, do you think that exits are a challenge, especially given the volatility right now?
So, you know, I think our view on exits has been, India has never been a country with a steady, you know, Excel sheet every year. You know, you can budget a certain amount of exits. It doesn't work that way. There are windows of opportunities and you have to be opportunistic about it. I think in the last 2 years, it's been a fantastic year for Chris Capital because we've actually taken a number of, you know, exits, taken a lot of companies public. You know, Eris went public, AU went public. So we're coming off of that back.
Right.
And I always say there's like 3-4 different businesses that we are in. We're not just in the investing business, right? We're in the fundraising business, we're in the deployment business. So when markets and valuations are relatively lower, that's when you hunker down and work, deploy more capital, work with your portfolio companies and build out, not necessarily, you know, look to optimize and exit in those environments. So certainly some plans will be, you know, put off or linger longer from an exit point of view.
Yes.
But you'll have to, you know, live through the cycle because this is a long tail investing business.
Right.
And there will be more opportunities in the future that will come about.
So Sanjay, one question that I've been asking all the investors to just gauge the investor sentiment is ahead of the elections and with border tension, how do you see the investment climate right now?
It's definitely cautious. There are issues, you know, not just at a macro level in India. I mean, of course, security and all of that is a big concern, but there are issues, you know, there's sort of global headwinds, you know, US economy, how does it play through, you know, the trade wars. It's a very volatile environment. So we're cautiously optimistic. We've raised a new fund. So we're excited about the opportunity that might, you know, present itself if some of these things were to play out. But we are not, you know, brushing in at this point, and we'll be calibrated in our approach to investments.
All right. Cautiously optimistic on that note. Thank you so much, Sanjay, for joining us. Thank you.
Appreciate it. Thank you so much for having me.
You've joined us on Big Deal, and let's take it straight across to Sanjeev Krishan of PwC joining us from Delhi. Sanjeev, so good to have you on CNBC-TV18. Now, I have been speaking to many private equity players. Like last week, it was Blackstone and Brookfield. Then we had Warburg Pincus as well as Chris Capital this time. And the overall private equity capital is becoming extremely important, especially for the stressed assets space. Do you think that more and more, especially global private equity firms, are getting more comfortable in involving themselves in IBC processes as well?
Definitely. I think if you look at the last 2 years, the IBC has definitely matured. I think it continues to reinvent itself and from an investor standpoint, today there are multiple opportunities. They can participate in a direct sale process. They can actually buy debt. They can actually buy a portfolio of banks' balance sheets. So, and release capital for banks. So in some ways, there are multiple opportunities for stress asset investors. And not just the stress asset investors who actually just focus on stress, but also investors, like as you mentioned, some of the names, they are actually now focusing on stress as a big theme in India. So stress is going to be a big theme, and it's already contributing very significant numbers in terms of M&A activity in 2018.
That's right, Sanjeev. And in fact, stress is not just coming in because of the NPAs that the banks had seen and because of which IBC processes had started. But now with the little bit of crisis that we saw in some of the NBFC companies, and there is an understanding that there could be more pain which could come out later, and therefore the pressure that is mounting on the real estate space, that is also seeing a fair bit of action. What do you have to say about that?
Yeah, so I would say three things. I think just to complete the IBC matter, I think, you know, the pre-IBC situations are very interesting for private equity investors, and that will continue to be a big theme. I think secondly, as you mentioned again, and very rightly so, there is some amount of stress building in. We can see that the public markets are struggling, and I think from a private equity standpoint, they love this situation because this would mean that they have a greater opportunity to deploy capital. And then coming, of course, to the real estate piece, I think I do agree. I think the commercial real estate has seen significant amount of transactions already in the year gone by, over the last 18 months or so. I think there are other pockets of opportunity which are there, and then of course there are possibilities for secondary or tertiary transactions in the commercial real estate space. So I would think that all those three would be big opportunities for 2019. I do believe that 2019 could be a bigger year for private capital because the public markets will be soft for a large part of the year.
Right. And we've already seen some of the fund action when it comes to the stressed space, may not be IBC, but definitely like CDPQ investing in an NBFC, Edelweiss, of course, taking forward their relationship, and also Brookfield looking to sign the deal with Hotel Leela Ventures. So all these are signs, even the prominence of Canadian pension funds coming out quite starkingly now, which had already invested quite a bit some time back, and now are looking and training their eyes towards the stressed asset space as well, Sanjeev.
I do agree. And, you know, completely, if you look at the whole non-banking financial space, I think they would definitely have a situation where liquidity is available by various means and ways. The cost of liquidity will go up. For instance, the transaction that you mentioned, the CDPQ one, and some of the others are going to be more and more visible. I think from an NBFC standpoint, there is a possibility for greater consolidation to happen. And it's a space that the private equity investors love. They have actually been investing on the growth cycle, particularly with the housing finance companies and others. And I think today there is an opportunity for them to participate on a selective basis, depending on where the criteria allows them, in consolidation of the whole NBFC space. So that, I think, I do agree, that's a big space for private equity investors in 2019.
And what about the other sectors? Which are the sectors outside of stress situations which you see are gaining more attention from the private equity sector?
So, from a private equity standpoint, I think, even if we look that this is going to be a year in which there is going to be, let's say, muted growth, or it's going to be a bit of an India down scenario, in an India down scenario, sectors like pharmaceutical, technology obviously come back. We always see a significant amount of interest in the consumer and the financial services space. And again, if you look at the kind of frenzied activity that we're currently seeing in the infrastructure space, particularly on the roadside, as well as on the renewable side, I think that's something which, to my mind, will create the biggest numbers for 2019. I think real estate will continue to be an important element, and supplemented by the pre-stress situations like the hospitality deal that you mentioned. I think those are the six or seven spaces segments where I would believe there will be maximum activity in 2019 from a PE standpoint.
Would you agree with me if I say that more or less most of the private equity players would be more in an investment mode than exit mode, also because of market volatility and therefore dampening of valuations, not giving an exit route at this point compared to what we saw a couple of years back, where most of the IPOs were really done to give an exit to private equity?
Absolutely, Nisha. I mean, if you look at it last year, it is a blockbuster year for exits. And I think a lot of funds have actually exited a significant amount of their investments, number of their investments. So the stress that people used to say, I think, has gone from an exit standpoint. And I would like to believe, and with fundraising has been pretty decent as well. So with good fundraising, exits done in 2018, I would think that 2019 is going to be an investing year more than ever before. And I won't be surprised if we do cross the $40 billion threshold in 2019.
All right, so that's a big number. Thanks so much, Sanjeev, for joining us here on CNBC-TV18. So that's the really word coming in from the entire private equity sector. Of course, it's gaining a lot of prominence when it comes to providing capital for growth in the Indian companies while the strategics are saddled with their debt concerns. With that, we wrap it here on Big Deal, but stay tuned to CNBC-TV18.